So welcome back to the session, Doctor. Before Dr. Shraddhanand arrives in another half an hour, he is on the way. We'll continue the pharmacology. Autonomic nervous system pharmacology is the most crucial thing, both autonomic nervous system physiology and pharmacology. To understand that is all about understanding pharmacology. So let's become experts in that. We have two kinds of people. People who become angry and the people who are cool guys. Angry is synonymous with sympathetic system. To be cool is all about parasympathetic system. So what is parasympathetic nervous system? You have one main nerve called vagus. Vagus, 10th cranial nerve. It is the one which carries with it the parasympathetic outflow. Vagus supplies heart, vagus supplies gut. So in all these places, parasympathetic innervation comes from vagus, is what need to be remembered. Can you please ask online students to punch whether the voice is loud and clear? Ask them in the online chat window to punch. That is vagus. Then there are some other cranial nerves. Oculomotor nerve, third cranial nerve. It also carries the parasympathetic innervation. It goes to the eye. And when parasympathetic innervation stimulates, pupil constricts, meiosis occur. So oculomotor nerve also is a carrier of parasympathetic outflow. So this is all called cranial parasympathetic outflow. One more place from where parasympathetic innervation comes out is from our sacral plexus. Thoracic plexus, lumbar plexus, sacral plexus, cervical plexus. So these are all the plexi from where nerves originate. Hence parasympathetic innervation is hence called craniosacral outflow. Craniosacral. Why call cranio? Because some cranial nerves like 10th nerve, 3rd nerve, they carry the parasympathetic out. And sacral plexus also carries it. From sacral plexus, parasympathetic comes out, it goes and innervates the bladder. When parasympathetic stimulates, bladder contracts and the urine passes out. So craniosacral outflow. From where sympathetic comes out, thoracolumbar outflow. Thoracic and lumbar plexus will spread the sympathetic out. Hence called thoracolumbar outflow is the name given for sympathetic outflow. So doctor, what is the difference between parasympathetic and sympathetic is a very important question. Whenever it leaves the spinal cord, whether sympathetic or parasympathetic, ultimately it will reach one ganglion. From the ganglion, postganglionic fibers will leave and they innervate the viscera, various viscera. So you have two types of fibers, preganglionic fibers, postganglionic fibers. Postganglionic ultimately will innervate the viscera. Both for sympathetic and parasympathetic. But the main difference is, if you take the parasympathetic, from where parasympathetic comes out? Through craniosacral outflow. When the vagus leaves as a cranial nerve, it will go all the way nearer to the gut. There it forms the plexus, ganglion. And the postganglionic fibers are very short because vagus only has reached until the gut. When the mountain can't move to Mahamad, Mahamad has to go to mountain. That is the state of parasympathetic. So summarize, preganglionic parasympathetic fibers are very long. After reaching ganglion, they ultimately innervate the gut. So postganglionic fibers are short. But sympathetic is not like that. it leaves the lumbar and thoracic part of the spinal cord. It comes out, forms the ganglion. From the ganglion, fibers travel a long distance and then innervate the organ. So preganglionic fibers of sympathetic system are shorter and the postganglionic fibers are longer. That is a one important difference is what need to be remembered. So once you know this, many other things are easy. What will for parasympathetic will be innervating? Everything that sympathetic innervates. Whatever the pencil big brother is having, younger brother also will have. Only thing is younger brother will have a longer pencil, elder brother will have a shorter pencil because he is elder. That is the only difference. But everywhere, if the sympathetic lead to bronchodilatation, parasympathetic lead to bronchoconstriction. So lot of places parasympathetic will have opposite effects to what sympathetic will have, but in few places both sympathetic parasympathetic will have same effects. Let's look into that. So doctor, parasympathetic ultimately innervates, right? So obviously what will you have? Where it ultimately innervates, you have receptors. What receptors? They are called postganglionic parasympathetic receptors. Before forming ganglion, your preganglionic fibers reach the ganglion. There, what is the receptor called? Preganglionic parasympathetic receptor. So accordingly, you have four varieties. What are they? Summarize: preganglionic parasympathetic, postganglionic parasympathetic, preganglionic sympathetic receptor, postganglionic sympathetic receptor. Now comes a very important question. Any receptor will be activated by one neurotransmitter. That is, the fiber will reach until that point and releases one neurotransmitter that will stimulate the receptor. Then from the receptor, the fiber continues. Then it reaches the postganglionic receptor. There once more the nerve ending releases a neurotransmitter and that stimulates the receptor, postganglionic receptor, and the organ contracts, dilates, secretes, don't secrete, whatever will happen. Common question asked in the exam is, what are the different types of parasympathetic receptors? We have nicotinic receptors and we have muscarinic receptors, two varieties of parasympathetic receptors. Which receptors we are talking about? Postganglionic receptors I am talking about. Postganglionic receptors. That is, parasympathetic left formed a ganglion, from that the postganglionic fibers went and they innervated some receptors. No, those receptors I am talking. You are having muscarinic and nicotinic. Which places do you have nicotinic? Where do you have muscarinic? Simple rule. Everywhere in the body, wherever the parasympathetic receptors, postganglionic are there, they are all muscarinic. Except neuromuscular junction. Neuromuscular junction means nerve ultimately goes and stimulates the muscle, no? There, the parasympathetic receptors are called nicotinic receptors. Autonomic ganglia. Parasympathetic fibers will go and stimulate the autonomic ganglia. There you are having nicotinic receptors. But everywhere else, if our salivary gland is stimulated and you are producing salivation, what are the receptors involved? Muscarinic. If your lacrimal gland is contracting and releasing lacrimal secretion, which receptors are stimulated by parasympathetic postganglionic fibers? Muscarinic. Everywhere it is muscarinic, except at neuromuscular junction in autonomic ganglia is what you need to basically remember. Now doctor, whenever you take a receptor, you have one preganglionic, you have one postganglionic. The neurotransmitter produced at the preganglionic receptor of the parasympathetic system is acetylcholine. Postganglionic, when the receptor is a muscarinic receptor, the neurotransmitter produces also acetylcholine. Then if you take the nicotinic receptors, there are few exceptions, but for the exceptions, most of the places the postganglion receptors are all parasympathetic system, means acetylcholine only is produced, is what you need to remember. Now let us talk about sympathetic. How about the preganglion fibers in sympathetic? Short or long? Thoracolumbar, they just come out and form a ganglia. From that, a long postganglion fiber will leave to ultimately innervate the organ. Right? So preganglionic are short, postganglionic are long, they come out from thoracic and lumbar area. That is the story of sympathetic system, is what need to be basically remembered. Now doctor, whether it is a preganglionic or postganglionic, in the case of the nervous system, both sympathetic and also parasympathetic, they form ganglia. Only difference is ganglia are closer to the organs in case of parasympathetic, and closer to spinal cord in case of sympathetic. So this you need to first understand. Now doctor, if you take sympathetic system, postganglionic fibers of all the sympathetic system everywhere, they produce epinephrine, catecholamines. But the exception is, you have sweat glands, no? Thermoregulatory sweat glands. Your palms will be sweating whenever you are tense, because when you are tense, your sympathetic system is activated. The postganglionic fibers will go and innervate the sympathetic receptors on the sweat glands, and they make the thermoregulatory sweat glands to secrete, right? Only in that area, postganglionic receptors basically produce acetylcholine. Otherwise, everywhere postganglionic sympathetic system means only catecholamines, not epinephrine. But only in the case of sweat glands, postganglionic fibers of the sympathetic system is cholinergic. Then how about